So I want to start actually with the end of the book, which is a little weird, but I like time traveling.
I'll take it.
So at the end of the book, you talk about how you felt a little awkward and conflicted about revealing your engagement online. And it struck me as a bit of a struggle with the private versus the personal. And when I was reading that, I thought you actually made a very interesting choice then to write a book that is extremely personal.
Right. So what I'm going to answer is what I say very commonly to this question, that on the Myers-Briggs scale, I score an 88% extrovert. And so I know you didn't want to use the word brave, but I think it would have been more brave for me not to write a book that was incredibly personal.
That's interesting.
I'm always very open about my life and the way I am, and I think that even though the site was incredibly personable and not necessarily personal, which is the line that I was treading with having to explain my engagement, I sort of decided to own the fact that people were going to know things about me, and I may as well use that for the sake of education or for the sake of making people feel like their issues are actually highly normal.
Right.
If that makes sense.
It does make sense. Okay. And have you...
Thanks.
The response on... You make sense. Good job.
Sometimes.
So the response online you mentioned in the book is kind of like a harsh backlash because, God forbid, the man repeller gets married.
Right.
And, you know...
Well, see, the thing about that is that I was also coming to terms with the fact that man repeller did not have to be this hyper-literalization of itself.
Okay.
You know, man repeller, the website, didn't necessarily mean that in order to be an incredibly stylish girl that is trying, not necessarily there, but trying to be smart too.
Right.
She has to be single. You know, that I think I was coming to terms with that during the process of my getting engaged. And so as a function of that, it was a little unusual. I turned it into a bigger deal than it had to be, I think.
You felt all the feelings.
I was offensive about it. I was like, you didn't stop celebrating Christmas after you heard Santa Claus was fake. What's the big deal, you guys? I likened myself to Santa Claus. What is that? It's like Kanye likening himself to Jesus. A little bit, right?
A little bit. So in terms of man repelling, the phrase man repelling, it's kind of like when you're making this Santa Claus comparison. Man repelling, calling yourself the man repeller, it's actually not about proactively repelling men, is it?
No, definitely not. I think that the trajectory of the site has changed so much since launch. I was only 20 when I started the site. I was a junior in college and therefore highly ignorant. and I think that as I've continued working on this site, the sort of ideology has become very fine-tuned and finessed, and I've been saying that it's a humorous website about serious fashion, a site about trends that women love and men hate, but I also very much want it to be this sort of discussion board or community where girls come just to be girls and feel good about that. And that's it.
That's valuable.
Cue claps. I'm just kidding.
Girl power. So, all right, why is it that trends women love, guys hate? What are we all subconsciously man repellers?
Yes, I do think that every woman has a little bit of man repeller in her. I think that man repelling is a condition that was permeating the fashion industry way before I identified it as man repelling. Reason, TBD. I'm going to intellectualize it a little bit and believe
Please.
That because the way that our psyches work is so complex and we're sort of making everything much more difficult than it needs to be or intellectualizing everything, we feel that way about fashion also. Like, jeans and a t-shirt are good, but you know what's better is if you put a skirt over the jeans, a sweater over the t-shirt, a leather jacket over that, a plaid shirt around your waist, and like maybe two different shoes on your feet, it's just going to be a lot better. You know
right.
what I mean?
Right.
So it's kind of the way, like, a guy not calling you is annoying, but it's not that bad. But because he hasn't called you, you probably had broccoli in your teeth, and therefore he didn't want to talk to you, and you said really stupid things, and he never wants to look at you again, and your eyes weren't the color he hoped they would be. You know what I mean?
Right. Well, it's almost, you know, a preemptive defense mechanism.
Absolutely.
The more layers you wear, the more you are protecting
Thank
yourself.
Thank you. Thank you for putting that in three words.
It's the best I could do. I won't wing that. Okay. So I want to talk about a certain chapter in your book called Bermuda Shorts.
Yes.
Yes. Which was by
That's
far...
That's the one where my brother calls me fat.
That's what I was getting to. So that was, when we talk about what you share that's private versus personal, that was an extremely personal chapter. Do you want to run through kind of what you touch on there?
Yeah, so I don't know who's read the book and who's not, but I'm going to, I guess, synopsize or summarize the gist of the chapter. I was at that coming of age moment where I wasn't a teenager yet, but I was really on the brink of becoming a teenager, and therefore all that I was craving was obviously acceptance, because when you're 16 years old, what else do you want? And I was away with my family and two other families, and it so happened that the families that we were with contained siblings that were my age and my older brother's age, and we were all getting ready to go out one night, and it was one of the first nights that I was being allowed to go out, or I was allowed to go out, and you know, it was very exciting for me. And my brother told me that I couldn't go with him after a very dramatic stint with trying on my mom's jeans, learning that they were too small on me. My mom has very thin legs. I made her stand up for that. and my brother came in and said, "When am I going to feel proud to take you out like my friends are proud to take their sisters out?" Which I took as a jab at my weight, because I was a little overweight, but my weight had never really been an issue for me. It was never something I thought about, and I felt really, really sad about that. And I vowed to lose a lot of weight. And at that point in your life, when you're, again, on the brink of sort of becoming an adult or a teenager or whatever it is, and you believe that you can control something like your weight. Oh, I ruined my delivery. Control was supposed to be the punchline. sorry.
Everyone forgot that happened.
Anyway, that was my gauge of control, and I believe that if I had this control, or I could control this manipulation over the way I looked, then everything would be okay, and that is sort of the exact vessel that brings on eating disorders and issues that women have with themselves. And I was very lucky, because when I was told that I got too thin and I needed to eat, I was like, that's great, I just want some food, and so I never had to go down that spiral, but I know that a lot of people sort of don't get out on the other end.
Well, before your brother even made a comment, your mother was definitely making comments, right?
Right, yes.
Why did that
so
not...
mean.
Sorry. But, I mean, that didn't quite resonate as
much. It's just, the comments that my mom made never came from a malicious place, and I know that my brother wasn't necessarily trying to be mean, but the fact that he truly believed that I was an embarrassment was very hurtful. Whereas with my mother, she just sort of felt like I was going through the same, I was on the same journey that she had been on. You know, she used to say things like, I was just like you when I was 15, I was so chubby, and then one day I just said, I'm not gonna be chubby anymore, and I wasn't chubby. You know, and
so easy.
So I think she just assumed that the trajectory of my life was going to be very similar to hers, and as a function of that, she tried to just tell me, based on the sort of circumstances of her experiences, that everything was going to be okay. That was the bottom line. Right. And so I never took them personally or offensively.
But once it was your brother?
Right. Once it was my brother, it didn't seem like he had the same interest in mind for me that my mom did. If I was 16, he was 17 and a half or 18. He was only thinking about how people looked. And I guess in his mind, he was like, is the bouncer at the door going to want to let this fat girl into the club? You know what I mean?
Right.
And so those were the thoughts that were running through my mind. It's just that I remember on that night, I was really, really upset, and I started crying. And my mom said, if you're so upset, then do something about it. And so I was like, fine, I will.
Well, what you did about in your exact words is that you wanted to get, I think I'm quoting this properly, so thin that he went into cardiac arrest.
Yeah, but he's not like me. You know, like I was going to kill myself to better mankind. He was just going to accidentally do it.
You were just going to sacrifice yourself to make him feel guilty.
Yeah.
You know, when you lost all of that weight, and I think you said it was about 30 pounds,
yes.
Which is a lot. When you lost that weight, you also realized that you really liked shopping again. Was that kind of like a fashion breakthrough moment?
That was a strange moment. I'm not sure if the response I'm about to give is a testament to my having intellectualized fashion so much, but I certainly did realize that, because I think I always wanted clothing to hang on me the way it did on hangers. You know what I mean? And so I would picture the way an outfit would look on me in my head, but it never actually looked that way on me when I actually put it on. And so when I found that things were looking the way I wanted them to look on me, I was like, this is great. And yeah,
That's interesting when you talk about the hangers and things kind of hanging, because at the same time we're dealing with these media images.
Absolutely.
Everywhere. We were totally inundated, mm-hmm. both, you know, from the 90s onward with this stick figure grunge thing, and even now models just, you know, being incredibly thin, and the clothes do hang, and that's kind of what we've come to believe is stylish.
Right.
I mean, how did that affect how you viewed your body at that point?
I don't think that it had a conscious effect on the way that I viewed my body then, but I think that the older that I get and the thinner that the girls around me, or not around me, but the thinner that models get and the more boyish they start looking, the harder it becomes to feel like you're initiated or part of fashion if you don't look like that. And that's it's a very hard thing to come to terms with.
How do you deal with that?
Well, my response is different because I don't necessarily feel like I need to fit a specific mold anymore, because Man Repeller it's become such a great medium or a platform where we can express what's good about fashion and bad about fashion, and so I'm not necessarily harping or dwelling on the way that I look as much as I used to, and I would hope that that is sort of transcending the boundaries of the site and bleeding into the way that the girls that are reading the site are feeling about the site. But I'm definitely very conscious of the fact that in order to feel fashion cool, there's a certain body image to sort of live up to.
Do you think that there's more that could be done? I mean, obviously this is a self-perpetuating cycle with the magazines and the photographers and frankly what we buy off of the newsstands. Do you think that, I'm wondering if there were to be a change with this, mm-hmm. and who knows if it will happen in this lifetime, God willing, but would it be on the part of the designers to start creating clothes that look better on more body types? Or who starts the change if there's
right.
going to be a change?
I don't know if it's the designers or the step that's directly before the designers, but I know that we had a story go up this afternoon about a very big trend that appeared for fall, and it was the very, very deep V's. And that's a trend that only works on a girl that is super flat. And even though I don't have much of a chest, that's still not a trend that I can sort of assume and make my own, only because I still have something of a chest. Yay, V! That's my honeymoon. But what the writer who wrote that story for the site is like a D. And she was saying that even though she loves it and it's beautiful on a flat girl, she can't necessarily do it because if she tries it, she's gonna look like Lil' Kim at the VMAs.
It's a good point.
Which is fine and whatever, and so we started that conversation, and I think her bottom line was to do something because you love it and to sort of dress your body the way that you wanna dress it no matter what the circumstances of that dressing is. But to go back to your point, I don't know that it's the designers so much as it is the step before the designers, which is the trend forecasting agencies and companies that are deciding that purple is going to be big and pants are not in.
That's tough, because that's actually a part of the cycle in the industry and the process that most people aren't very familiar with.
Like, yeah.
We generally think that it starts with the designers, mm-hmm. right? But you're actually referring here to an entire industry that's pre-designer, right?
Yeah, it's
so how do they trend forecast exactly, to your knowledge? Like, I mean, is it to the point where they're like, this is the physique for the season?
I have no idea. If I did know, I'd be in a very different place.
Fair enough.
But I don't know.
Fair enough. So when you came out of the period in your teens with the food, in the book, you say very much that a doctor tells you you are in danger, you need to get it together. And as you said here just now, like, oh, awesome, great, I want to eat again. Mm-hmm. Was that it?
Well, no. I credit a lot of the fact that I didn't go through withdrawal to the fact that I met my husband, who was not my husband at the time. I think I was 17 and I hadn't gotten my period for about 5 months. And my doctor said that I was on the brink of infertility and that I clearly needed to be eating more, but my thyroids were tested and I didn't have any I guess, medical disorders. And I started dating him, and my thought process was, I can't be dating this guy and going out for dinner and ordering, like, Leafs.
Right.
You know what I mean? And so I guess the first leg of our relationship was only about 9 months. But those very much to me feel like the 9 months that informed the following years.
Right.
So I was so happy and elated that I'd met this guy that I really liked. He's okay. He's not that good. Just kidding. That I was so happy and elated that I met him that I couldn't think about anything else. It was just a matter of A, working hard to get into the college that I wanted to get into, B, making sure that our relationship was still going well, and C, ham.
Ham?
Yeah. That's it.
What do you mean by ham? Just like meat?
When I say, never mind.
Oh, hard as a motherfucker?
Yeah.
Oh, God, I look like an old person now.
No.
Sorry, I'm like, why aren't we swearing? Why can't we just swear? Okay, sorry, family venue. So, okay, let's talk about college.
Okay.
Because in your chapter, Maxi-Skirt, right? Mm-hmm. And if you haven't read the book, what Leandra does quite brilliantly is she uses clothing as a device in every chapter of this memoir. So, you know, Bermuda shorts are an entry point to talking about these were the shorts that she could just fit in that summer, and that's what you were wearing all the time. And in this Maxi-Skirt chapter, which I read is very much a figuring out who you are sort of phase, the maxi skirt is kind of the entry point both in who you were in day school and mm-hmm. high school and then coming back to that.
Right.
Can you explain a little bit?
Well, that was a very difficult chapter for me. When people ask me how long it took me to write this book, I say all in about 5 weeks, but with the editing, about 8 months. And I would say that I spent about 2 months working on this chapter alone just because it was certainly the meatiest, and I think tackled this very unique time in my life that I would imagine every girl has to deal with. But so the informative years of your life are in high school. You know, whoever you are in high school is going to inform who you are no matter how much you want to disagree with that, only because so many things happen in those years that you can't shake off. And because I went to a school that was so restrictive about the dress code, and I'm very much the type of person who likes to think, or doesn't like to think, but knows that fashion is a very, very good way to allow you to assume different identities. You can step into different costumes every day and be whoever the hell you want to be.
And that's the most. For a second. Okay. When did you figure that out?
That?
Yeah.
Probably around this time.
Really?
Or maybe not. Maybe I figured it out while I was writing the book.
Interesting.
Yeah.
You know, because it, all right, sorry, go back.
So it seems like, so assuming different identities, that's where we were, right?
Right, and the maxi skirt.
Yeah,
and
it just, I guess, it was when I was writing the book, because as I was writing this chapter, there were so many epiphanies occurring in my head, and I wasn't quite sure where to take the chapter, because originally, the most important part is that Joan Didion was the first writer that turned me on to becoming a writer, and then it became this entire different chapter about the fact that I was trying so hard to become something and know what I wanted to be and explain to people around me who were asking, what do you want to do? These are the years that inform the rest of your life. What are you going to do with them? Tell them that I wanted to be whatever it was I wanted to be, a scientist or a dancer. By the way, I took jazz class in this room for like 5 years. I'm really good at rolling my shoulders.
Jazz hands.
Yeah. We never did jazz hands. That is
myth.
That is a complete manifestation of Bring It On.
Really, the myth of jazz hands.
Yes.
Oh man.
Anyway, so back to the maxi skirt.
So the maxi skirt was part of your
right. Well,
uniform,
I felt like yes, it was part of my uniform. I had to wear. We were only allowed to wear muted tones. It was black, white, gray, or navy. And we had to cover our shoulders and our knees, and my best friend would go to Brooklyn at the beginning of every year and buy all of these skirts for the two of us. It was like three of the same skirt, they just needed to be washed very often. And I would wear this outfit to school every day, and I was very driven and enthused by fashion, and so I would read magazines, and my school was in a very trendy neighborhood because it was on 70th and Madison, and so there were two very high-end boutiques on the block of my school and some fancy coffee shops, and we would see fashion happening around us, but we couldn't participate in it. And I always looked at it, and I looked at it with such longing eyes, and I really wanted to feel a part of it, and I never could. And it felt so strange to me that the school was sort of hindering our ability to be part of this personality cultivation, even though, as it turned out, that wasn't the case. And I loved my school, and I hope that my kids can go to a school like that one. But
you did try to get around that a little bit. I'm thinking
right,
specifically
I did. I wore neon
crop
sneakers.
Top.
And I wore neon sneakers. I got sent home for that.
But
so
you
mean.
Wore the crop top.
I did.
Thinking.
Well, it was a makeshift crop top. It wasn't really a crop top. Remember when hip huggers were in and a little bit of a thong coming out of the back of your jeans was really cool?
High point in fashion culture.
So it was just like this showing. And I got sent home for that. It was so mean. I was not thin at the time. So it wasn't even like, nothing was showing, but this like roll of skin that people were like, that part of the shirt, is that a peplum? You know? It was not a peplum, that was my body. Oh, it was beautiful.
You mentioned
days.
Joan Didion as being a point at which you realized you wanted to be a writer.
Yes.
How exactly did she, like in the book, there's a moment where you're goofing off in class and the teacher is tired of you talking or making noise and he throws Slouching Towards Bethlehem on your desk.
Right.
And that was a major epiphany for you.
Joan Didion is the kind of writer that makes you feel like your thoughts are as smart as hers are. And so the fact that I believed that I could think for myself was a groundbreaking moment for me. Because to me, it was always consume this information and regurgitate it when we give you a test. Right. And so to feel like I could read something and cultivate my own opinion on it and deliver that opinion and have that opinion applauded was very, very special for me. And so I've always associated that situation with Joan Didion. I remember so well, I was reading Goodbye to All That. And I can't remember what line I read, or I tell what some people call lies. And I raised my hand and I was like, this is so interesting. She's saying that it's not really a lie as far as she's concerned. She's saying that some people think it's a lie, but she doesn't really think it's a lie. And she's just like, yeah, go continue. And right. And I was like, it's all about subjectivity. And I kept going on that. And that is a very seminal point as far as I'm concerned. You know, I mean, I still remember it, and this is years ago.
It's a breakthrough moment
yeah.
in terms of what you wanted to do.
Yeah.
And it was at that point you decided you wanted to be a writer.
Right.
And what kind of writer did you want to be from the get-go?
I thought I was going to be a reporter. I was very adamant or eager about getting like a fact-checking job at New York Magazine after graduating. But then I started Man Repeller, and I wasn't applying for fact-checking jobs.
Well, you talked about, actually, in the book, at certain points, you talked about some internships and jobs you had, and you were writing, right, during some internships?
Yes.
But was it fashion writing or celebrity writing?
No, it was celebrity writing. I felt like the human version of TMZ.
Oh.
It wasn't fun.
Wasn't fun.
Lindsay Lohan steps out.
Did you
in
get...
in green dress.
So
her legs
are
looking
writing,
freckly.
Kind of. So when did you not make the transition into writing about fashion until literally when you started the website?
Well, when I was abroad in Paris, I started a blog, and the blog was called 4 Months in Paris, and it was chronicling my time abroad. Okay. And I started that site because I didn't want to have to send emails to every family member every time something interesting happened, or not that interesting, but they just wanted to know what was happening. And that, to me, was really valuable because I was a journalism student at school. And so to have this forum for me to write in an unedited capacity was really, really special.
Right.
And it was after that that I decided I really wanted to continue sort of just nurturing an online portfolio. And I didn't know what would happen with it, and I didn't really care what would happen. I just wanted to do it. And that's how Man Repeller was born.
Okay. Well, writing's a muscle. You have to.
It is.
And blogs are great for that because,
yeah.
you know, whether you have an audience or not, you can exercise the muscle and get stronger and eventually launch your own site. But
yeah.
You mentioned Paris, which brings me to the chapter, the ostrich skin clutch. And
my grandmother's here.
Is Grandma here?
Grandma, it's your turn to stand up. Okay, she's not going to stand up.
So in this chapter, you talk about finding an Hermes clutch.
Mm-hmm.
In your grandmother's closet.
Yes.
Now, in the book, you include a picture of this clutch.
Mm-hmm.
It is lovely. It's also very simple. Mm-hmm. What really, and we're getting to Paris because she takes it to Paris, right? You take it to Paris. But at that moment, you just had to have that clutch. What was it about that object? Was it the fact that it was Hermes? Was it just beautiful in its simplicity? Or was it the fact that it was your grandmother's and you didn't know she had it?
It was a perfect storm. I think it was a combination of my being blinded by the label. I saw that it was this exotic skin Hermes bag. I was a 19 or 20 year old girl, and I didn't have very many fancy things. And so the fact that it belonged in my family seemed very fancy to me, because if it belonged to me or my grandmother or my mother, it didn't matter, because it was still effectively mine, wasn't it?
Right.
And so that was definitely a point of victory for me. And yeah, the memories that my grandmother always relays are so, they're so romantic and beautiful. And she's from Turkey, and she spent her summers in France, and her life just seems so much more beautiful than mine does. Well, it's also, our world is not as glamorous as say their world was, and I don't know if that's because I don't know if that's because we've romanticized it so much, or if it's because of the internet. It's always the internet's fault.
Everything is the internet's fault, for sure. But I do think that when you talk about us not being as glamorous, who knows what our grandchildren are going to think of this.
Right.
Maybe they're going to think blogs are really fabulous.
Or maybe they're going to be like, why were you wearing those white patent leather Birkenstocks, you freak? We're not going to Monaco to hear Frank Sinatra sing.
No, this is true.
We've got Michael Bublé, and he's singing Frank Sinatra songs.
And you can listen to him online on YouTube
yeah.
from the safety of your basement.
Yeah, Miracle on 42nd Street or 49th Street. Where is that miracle happening? 49th?
I'm not even sure. I don't even know. I didn't know miracles happened in Manhattan. Okay. So back to the clutch. Mm-hmm. So, you know, this magic object for you, you finally finagle it and you take it
yes.
to Paris. And what happens in Paris?
I vomit inside of it. I get very, very drunk. I vomit inside of it.
Impressive that you had the wherewithal to actually barf in the purse, because you took everything
right, so
out.
So that's
even.
When I knew that if ever I needed to go into survival mode, I would be able to. You know what I mean?
No, it was
no
very
matter
impressive.
What state I was in.
She actually took everything out of the purse uh-huh. and got it on the cab seat. And
yeah.
Before I,
including a couple stray receipts.
I mean, and you held on to those, I assume, obviously.
I sure
and then
did.
you wash the bag, and you find out later, you confess to your grandmother. How many years later?
It's counterfeit.
Did it matter at that point?
No, of course not. But I very, very vividly remember that I told my grandmother what had happened, and I was so afraid to tell her because she was so adamant about my taking care of it and using it in good health, and I did not take care of it and I did not use it in good health, as evidenced by the vomit. And as I was telling her that I threw up inside of it, she started giggling. And I said, what is so funny? I'm about to confess. This is my moment of confession. You know, I'm coming out. You know what I mean?
As a puker.
Yeah. And I proceeded to tell her the rest of the story, and she's like, I bought that at a flea market. You know? It was just so great. I was also, it was so, I knew that I was my grandmother's granddaughter because she was so tickled by my fear. You know, instead of trying to nurture it and be like, don't worry about it. You know, she waited. She knew that the outcome of the story was going to be my screwing something up. And she just wanted to hear me say it to be like, ha ha.
There's an element of tough love in that, in a way, right?
Right, and that is my grandmother.
And I think, to an extent, from what I could glean from the book, that's kind of what you grew up with your mother, too, right?
Yeah.
A little bit?
Yeah.
And she was, you talk about her fashion sense, and it's definitely not peplum, but yeah. How much did your mother influence, you know, your relationship with fashion?
Well, I think my relationship with fashion has been heavily influenced by both of my parents, which might just be by nature of their not being American. My mom spent a lot of her childhood in Milan, and my dad is from Turkey, but he's also my grandmother's son. So that
okay.
that maybe lends itself to
right.
his being a little, I mean, he would buy a pair of red pants over a pair of plain denim jeans any day of the week.
Just because you can.
Right, or just because he can.
Okay.
Like he likes to monochrome orange. It's very funny. My dad is a very good dresser.
So your grandmother's style too. You talk a lot about raiding her closet. Was that a big? Was that even more so influential than your parents?
Well, I think the thing with my grandmother is that when vintage clothing became so popular, I never felt like I had to become a part of that movement because my grandmother had all the treasures that anyone could dream of finding at an Ina or, you know, wherever it is.
Right.
So I feel very lucky that I have both my mom and my grandmother because I don't have to buy old clothing and just take theirs.
So throughout college, until the point where you got married, you lived at home with your father and your mother. And something you write about very tenderly in the book is the moment the night before your wedding and even your wedding day with your mother. At some point, there was a change in your relationship with your mom,
right,
where it went from, I'll continue to say, tough love to almost a BFF level.
Yeah, right. Well, so my freshman year of college I lived out, and my sophomore year of college I lived out, and then I moved back home after I was abroad because my dad's like, the party's over, bitch, you're coming home. But I think the reason that I had such a hard time with moving out after my wedding is because, in spite of the fact that I tried so hard and actively to change the trajectory of my life, because as much as I respected my mother, I never really wanted to become her. Sorry, Mom. I'm really sorry. She's crying, guys. When she got married, both of her parents got sick almost immediately. She lost her father really quickly after her wedding, and then she lost her mother a few years after she got married. And so because I have this fear of history repeating itself, I was very afraid that my getting married signaled the sort of terminality or the final point of their lives. And so I think that was something that was very difficult for me to come to terms with. And I was at a wedding last night and I watched the bride's parents kiss her and, you know, the groom sort of come and collect her and take her to the altar. And it just, maybe because I've again intellectualized the process of getting married so much and it was something that I did for months before I got married, it seems like a very sad, the end of an era is always very sad, you know? And so you're no longer your children's daughter anymore. You become this man that you know, but you don't know as well as you will ever know you start to know them as well as you'll know your parents, but you certainly don't know them as well as you've known your parents. And your parents are sort of saying, okay, you know, it's like the first day of preschool. They're like, you have to go, I'm gonna go to work and you're gonna go to school. And, but if you think about it, you spend the first 2 years of your lives in your parents' arms, and they're catering their lives or tailoring the course of their lives to match what you need to do. And then you go to school and they start being humans again. They start being functioning members of society. And they're not just your parents. They're also working at shops and companies or whatever it is. And so it's that marriage is very much that way, where you're no longer your parents' child before anything else anymore. You become your husband's wife.
Right. And in a way, it's never, after you're married, it's not you anymore.
Right,
it's you
absolutely.
And your husband. You are permanently part of a team.
Yeah.
Even though when you're in a home with your family, you can say, team, family, we're all together.
Right.
But it's very different when you are suddenly, very suddenly, the head of the household. And you went quite abruptly from being the child in the household straight to being the head of the household. How did that, I mean, you talk in the book about going back to the house after the wedding and feeling, going back to your parents' home, and it's kind of bittersweet.
Yeah.
But how, in the long run, you've been married a year now, right?
Yeah,
a little over a year. How has that adjustment felt for you?
The first few times I went home were very nostalgic for me. I got very sad, and I think I just have a very bad case of separation anxiety. I still sleep with my childhood blankie, and my husband tries to hide it from me, and he's trying to get me away. It's like, I'm like, it could be worse. At least I'm not addicted to cocaine, you know what I mean? Just a blankie, jeez. He's trying to take it away from me. But anyway, the first few times I went home were very, very nostalgic. And we slept home one night. I think it was like Yom Kippur night. And it's just we couldn't go home afterwards because we live on First Street. And when we left that Saturday night after the fast, I was so sad to leave because I felt like my parents' kid again. And it just reminded me that I wasn't really their kid anymore. You know, your priorities shift. But the first year of marriage is hard, and then afterward it becomes really, really beautiful. And I think that the reason no one talks about how difficult getting married is because after you do it, you forget how hard it was on yourself.
Mm-hmm. By hard on yourself, do you mean the decision to get married and the transition?
Right. It's a matter of you holding on to the past because it's the only thing you're certain of. You're certain of two things in life. You're certain that you're going to die, and you're certain of what's behind you. You know what I mean? And so getting married is this sort of testament to the fear of future. That's it. Drops mic.
Yeah, I was like, whoa, okay. So a year and a half in, do you still have that feeling when you go home?
No, I very, very much feel, even though I'm still a Medine, I very much feel like a Coen. So it's not a matter of prioritizing anymore. It's just a matter of knowing that I'm building a family, and one day I'm going to do for children what my parents did for me, and the way to do that is to give my energy, attention, love, and focus to the entity that's going to help that.
It's a real adjustment to realize you are now in charge of creating your own separate unit.
Yeah.
But it's definitely a building block part of a larger home and a larger family, but suddenly you're in charge of this unit, and whatever that unit becomes, that's on you.
Right.
And it's the situation your parents were in, too, in a way.
Right. Well, I also feel like I'm part of a team in a way that I wasn't before, which is nice.
That's really cool.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think it's twofold. I'm lucky in that certain events have sort of led to my realizing that I'm part of a team. You know, it's the sort of those almost life-altering but not quite life-altering events that help you realize that you're not swimming alone. You're wearing a life vest, and that life vest presents itself as the person that wakes up next to you. But I don't know that everyone is able to realize that off the bat.
Is that kind of one of those things you talk about the first year just now, the first year of marriage being very difficult? Is that a realization you come to at some point?
Yeah, yes. I think it's a lot of that. I think it's a lot of, it's just a lot of the getting through the banalities of the day and finding the sort of magic in them.
Right. Someone every day, forever.
Yeah.
That forever is heavy.
Yeah.
All right, I'm going to change tacks here. Right. We're going to talk about periods.
We're going to talk about vaginas.
Let's talk about vaginas. So because I'm a disgusting person, my personal favorite chapter was...
The period panties.
The period panties, which, for me, period panties are anything disgusting that I don't want my husband to see. But for you, period panties are actually kind of nice.
Yeah.
They seem really nice.
They're high-waist. They're lacy.
They're black. Right. So... Period panties, again, a device to talk about your first period. And what really struck me was that you lied.
I did, right.
Can you explain your lies?
Right. Well, I was at a friend's house in New Jersey, and all of my friends had gotten their period already, and so I sort of felt like they were initiated and wiser than I was just by virtue of having gotten their periods already, and they could talk about tampons and pads, and I couldn't do that yet. That was so alien to me. And I was at my friend's house, and we were eating french fries and ketchup. And
ominous.
I went to the bathroom, and I realized that I had a stain on my underwear, and I was so thrilled by the stain. And I called my mom, and I was so excited, and I went into my friend's room, and I was like, do you have a pad that I can borrow? I don't know that I'll give it back. And my mom was really upset that I wasn't home to get it, and she turned it into such a big deal, and I came home, and she was so excited, and she hugged me, and it felt like such a big to-do that after I found out that it was actually ketchup, I just couldn't tell her that it was ketchup.
How did ketchup get in your underwear?
We were in our underwear. We were watching TV. I was sitting like this. I don't know.
Oh, okay. So you didn't have the heart to tell your mom?
No, certainly. No, she wrapped underwear for me. And she also, I think she turned my getting my period into this experience to connect me to my grandmother that I never got to know, my mother's mom, because her mother had told her to wear black underwear when she had her period. And it was sort of a legacy that she was trying to pass down. And so I didn't want to ruin that for her.
Did your friends think you'd gotten your period that night
too?
And you continued to lie?
Yeah.
How many months?
Just like 3 or 4, like a year.
So
like 36 more months.
So, which leads me to a bigger question, which is that in my personal experience too, girls lie about periods, just in general, whether they have them, whether they hurt, this and that, especially when we're young, when we are in junior high. Why is that?
Judy Blume.
It's
it.
How did Judy Blume raise a generation of liars?
She completely glamorized the process of getting your period. That stupid asshole, Margaret. Jeez.
Again, lies.
Are you there, God? Really? Really?
Well, it's also, I mean, it has something to do, I think, a little bit with the eagerness of young women to grow up.
Become a woman. Absolutely.
To become a woman.
I think that happens a lot with girls and their virginity also. I think it's something that you kind of just, at a certain point, you want to give away. You just don't want it anymore. It's not a matter of the sacrosanctity of having it.
Right.
You just don't want it to be there. I'm kidding, Dad. I'm still a virgin.
So, speaking of the night you didn't lose your virginity, in the book you write about that night where nothing happened,
yeah.
And in the middle of the non-consummation, you say something to the extent that you're thinking about your socks.
Yeah, I didn't take them off. I forgot.
So, of all moments, like, what? I mean, why the socks? Why was that what stuck out in your mind?
Because I ruined the moment.
I mean, do you think he even noticed?
Obviously.
I'm pretty sure
it took
like
four more years for us to get back together. I don't know that he noticed. I think that's one of the things that girls, it's this complexity of being a woman. You
right.
know, it's just one of those things where, oh my God, it was the socks. The socks ruined everything. And, you know, that becomes the benchmark of.
Right. But you have to blame yourself for something.
Of course.
If something didn't go perfect, it's your fault. It's
like
the socks'
I have a friend
fault. You didn't
who
wear
says,
the right thing.
I have a friend who says that when she leaves a doctor's office, if she's not diagnosed with anything, she feels ripped off. You know?
It's a good point. It's validation, though. It's
yeah.
knowing that it's not just you. It wasn't.
Mm-hmm.
It's not just you. It's the white socks.
Mm-hmm.
It's not just.
And that's the thing about man repelling is when you're using that to quantify you're still being single, it's not about you. It's about a choice that you're making to dress a certain way. And that puts the relationship status in your control, which is kind of nice.
So with the lying, both sex and periods or whatnot, it strikes me as kind of a passive-aggressive, competitive girl thing, right?
Mm-hmm.
Did you feel that way amongst your friends? Was it conscious for you?
Yes. I think that my middle school friends and high school friends were very different people. Actually, that's not true, because my two closest friends from high school are still my two closest friends in life, but they were also my only real friends in high school. But I think, especially going to a Jewish school, it sort of lends itself to this genre of very catty girls that are sort of taught to be a certain way by their surroundings, be it their cousins or mothers or whatever it is. And there was a lot of my having to fake things.
How so?
I believe. And I think that I look back at it now, or fake things like all their moms would play tennis together, and I'd be like, yeah, my mom totally plays tennis. She's a freaking tennis pro. Are you going to the U.S. Open? She's going to be there. You know what I mean? My mom was like, I don't care about
it's
tennis.
It's a matter of trying to keep up, right?
Yeah, right. Or they just did all these things that were so alien to my mother because she wasn't from here,
right.
And they were all having lunch on the Upper West Side, and she was like, I don't know how to get across that park. Because, I mean, we became Americans together. My mom had us, very soon after she came to the United States. And so it was, I really grew up with my parents. And I say to my husband now that I hope that our kids can sort of harbor this sense of differentiation, because I think that that's how character is built, is not feeling like everybody that's around you. And for us, it was our parents not really getting it and us having to navigate the waters together, and my brother have to tell me that I'm not supposed to roll my R's. Or
when,
enunciate
when did you
my
discover,
T's.
When did you find that out?
I must have been like 8.
Well, at least it was young.
Teen.
18.
But yeah. I think there was a lot of my feeling like I needed to be not I needed to be, but I wanted to be accepted. But I would come home and I'd be able to take the blinds off, and that was really, really beautiful for me. Blinders, not blinds.
So but when you're talking about being accepted, you're talking about via your mother too, right?
Yeah, everything is via my mother.
A lot of layers there with
yes.
mom, right?
Right. Any daughter's relationship with her mother is this onion that will not. It just, you can't get to the core. There's
what
no core.
What is it about? It's interesting. I had a friend who said once that she wanted a boy because the boy wouldn't hate her at 16, whereas it's a given that the daughter will eventually hate you.
That is so interesting, because there's this story that somebody, I don't remember where I first heard, someone sort of marketed it to me as a joke, but it was not a joke. It was it's a very touching, I guess, metaphor for life, where this couple just gets married, and they decide that for 48 hours after their wedding, they're not going to talk to anybody but each other, and they're going to sort of acclimate themselves to life together. And the day after the wedding, the boy's family comes knocking and knocking. They want to congratulate them and recap the wedding and talk about things. And the boy does not answer the door. The door goes unanswered. And then the following day, the mother's parents come, and they're knocking and knocking and knocking, and they won't leave the door. And the girl starts crying, and she's like, I can't leave my parents outside. We have to open the door. So they open the door. 10 years later, they have children. First, they have a boy. They don't, if they have the boy, it's great, whatever. They don't celebrate. I mean, they celebrate, but they don't celebrate his life. And then they have a daughter, and the father throws this huge party for the daughter. And the mother says, why we didn't throw a party for the son. Why are we throwing this party for our daughter? And he was like, because she's always going to open the door for us, and he might not, you know? And that was that story always really resonated with me. It always seemed very special.
It's interesting because at some point in your book, you also talk about you're the only daughter, correct?
Yeah.
And at some point you sensed at home, I think your words were, a creeping sense of gender inequality.
At home. Right.
Yeah. Can you expand on that?
That might just be a function of having grown up among three brothers and parents from the Middle East.
How so?
Neither of my parents were ever taught that women should work, and it was never necessarily an urgency for a girl to be educated. And I can't fault my parents for having grown up that way, and I certainly can't fault, I mean, I can fault society until the end of tomorrow, but I think that they always believed it was a much more important, or not always, they believed that initially it may have been a more important task to invest in a boy's education, because the supposition was that he was going to grow up and need to fend for a family, whereas a girl was going to get married and sort of be on the other side of that fending. But my dad was always very adamant about reminding my mother that I was going to have a corporate life and therefore didn't need to learn how to cook.
We talked earlier, spoiler, we had some drinks before this, and we spoke about cooking, actually.
We did.
And your struggle with, see, now we're talking about real lady business, cooking. And
lady
we talked about your struggle with cooking, and because it reminds you of your mother.
Right. I should say that when my dad used to call me a corp girl, I would cry when I was really young.
Why is that?
I think I'm digging myself into a hole. I don't know if I should continue with this thought. But I must have been like 12, 13, 14 at the time, and I was always an arguer, and my parents were like, maybe you should be a lawyer. And I was like, I don't think I want to be a lawyer. That's a lot of school. You guys should all be lawyers. I should go to law school.
Yeah.
No? Okay. But my dad used to say that to me, and I always associated working with not ever getting married. And
interesting.
And to me, the actualizing process always included a mate. And then as I got older, that became less and less true, and I think that's what sort of lended itself to my being able to get married, is that I wasn't necessarily thinking in terms of I need a companion as much as I was. I feel so full from the love I'm giving myself.
Which is good.
That I wonder if I'm ever going to need anyone.
I mean, but to get to that point in your early 20s
remarkable. That's really, it's super, super special. And I always tell that to people that are like, I'm looking for Mr. Right. I'm like, you need to make yourself Mrs. Right for you first, you know?
Right.
But with my parents and cooking, I think my mom was just always telling me that the way to a man's heart is through his stomach. And though that was the case, among other fantastic qualities that my mom has, to my dad's stomach, I was always very afraid of falling onto that same trajectory, because I don't know, we would be at Bloomingdale's or wherever, and she would see a set of wine glasses that she really loved, and she really wanted them, and she'd call my dad and say, I want these wine glasses, can I get them? And my dad would almost always say yes, because he's an incredibly generous individual, but I hated the fact that she had to ask anyone. You know, I always just wanted to be able to do that on my own. I wanted to know that if I wanted a pair of shoes or a stupid, like, useless, feudal jug, I could get it. No one calls them jugs anymore, right? Sorry. I always associated becoming well-versed in the kitchen with staying home and having to ask someone for things.
Which is something that was never
right, and that wasn't
for you.
It was never comfortable for me, and I'm coming to terms with the fact that it's not the case at all, and I found myself hungry to learn how to cook for the last 3 months because, number one, I'm hungry.
Right.
Number two, I'm trying to eat healthier.
Right.
And number three, I hate when my husband comes home and he's like, I'm hungry, and I'm like, me too. What do we do? You know? I think the three times we've used our kitchen, he's cooked us meals.
It's pretty logical. Oh, okay.
Oh, I guess okay. It's time for your questions.
I guess we're going to end on the cooking note and talk about some audience questions here that you guys submitted. So let's start with the first one. You said all women are subconsciously man repellers. Do you think this is because when we are man attractors, we get objectified, harassed, and slut-shamed?
No, I think this is, well,
I mean, it's kind
of true. A lot of slut-shaming is happening between women. I don't think that very many men are actually slut-shaming women. I think I'm on the other end of that because I'm married now.
I mean, I think there's, yes, I agree. It's predominantly women. Like, we are not necessarily forgiving towards one another as our half of the species. But I do think there's a degree of slut-shaming when things go awry, when something goes wrong, when the news is not good, when something happens, then it becomes slut-shaming.
Right.
You know, when we're talking about men in power or
passing judgment.
Right,
right, right. So, okay, we're talking about sort of terms like slut and whore just being used far too casually and liberally.
What did you think about slut walk and reclaiming slut? And is that something you're kind of behind, or is the word just beyond hope?
It's really hard. I don't know that those are terms that we should ever be claiming. I think that sort of feeds into the sort of self-deprecating nature of Gen Y and the needing to, it's very much in line with what Lena Dunham is doing with girls, and I'm a big fan of Lena Dunham, actually, but I just don't know that we need to identify and address every issue that is existing among women and exploiting it and turning it into an issue that we own. I think it's okay if we just divorce ourselves from it.
Fair enough. So in terms of, I'm actually interested with this question of the difference between a repeller and a conscious attractor, or are they both subconscious, or can you be consciously either? I mean, I guess technically
the way that I've always identified being a man attractor has been, because you can't help it if just by nature of being who you are, you're very sexy. Like, some women just gesticulate in this very attractive way, and that's great, you know, more power to them. But the difference to me between a man repeller and a man attractor is that a man repeller is dressing for herself and feeling really confident in the decision that she's made, and a man attractor is feeling really uncomfortable in her own skin because she's putting on a bodycon dress that she didn't want to wear in the first place, she kind of regrets buying, and is just wearing because she has it and believes that that's the way to sort of lure in this man.
Right. So it kind of comes down to what we were talking about earlier with the self-confidence and just...
Absolutely.
To be fair, there are plenty of women in bodycon dresses who are completely attractive
right.
and completely
but
comfortable.
Right, but I'm not necessarily considering those girls man attractors so much as I am just feeling... But are they really feeling comfortable?
I don't know. I mean, I think it depends on the women.
It's literally... you can't sit like this.
Actually, when you say you...
You know?
It is, yes, especially if there's boning. But, you know, when you're talking about whether or not they're man attractors or not, I think that's interesting because I actually... When I'm just thinking about how I, you know, I'm guilty of as much as the next woman of thinking certain things. When I think of man attractors, it's almost less, it's more conscious. Whereas, mm-hmm. I mean, there are plenty of women who are men attractors and are not doing it consciously. Like you said, they exude sexiness.
Right.
But, you know, they exude sexiness and they also opt for the dress. And I think what you're saying here is like, when you opt for the dress, are you really just opting, are you opting for it for yourself? Which is an interesting question because we're talking about, you know, jorts and harem pants,
right.
and you're definitely opting for those for yourself.
Yeah.
So can you opt for it for yourself when it's an uncomfortable bodycon dress?
I absolutely. I can't put words into any other woman's mouth. Those are not the things I'm opting for in my own, and in my own personal experience, I have found that every time I've dressed in a way that I believed would attract a man, it certainly has attracted a man, but...
Some man.
Singular. But, well, the thing about my husband is that he was always so much more enthused and excited by my more adventurous and very female empowering outfits. I mentioned it in the book in the chapter called The Harem Pants, where we ran into each other on a subway and I was wearing harem pants, and his reason for liking them and wanting to have a drink with me that night was because I looked so happy. And I was like, oh, they were very roomy. Thank you.
Okay, let's go to the next one. All right. What do you think is going to happen to the magazine industry now that bloggers publish content as it's happening while magazines publish several months later?
Well, a lot of magazines have full functioning and very robust websites. I think that we're always going to exist hand in hand. And I've mentioned this in an interview before. I don't know what medium we're going to exist in, but I know that we are both going to exist as separate entities. And I think that's okay because we're sort of facilitating the growth of each other.
Right, they're not mutually exclusive
properties.
No,
absolutely not.
But
that's what's beautiful about the internet, is that you don't have to have one favorite magazine that you can only spend $4 or $5 on a week. You can, or on the internet, I mean, you can read as many blogs as you want.
It's a zero-sum game.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, you can talk about competition online between blogs and magazine websites, but at the end of the day, I'm not sure that anyone loses readers to one or the other. Like, you just...
In fact, we help each other.
It's pretty symbiotic.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. This is a good one. You mentioned that you met your husband at a very formative time in your life. How much influence does your husband have on your clothing choices? How much say does he have in what you wear?
He is so uninvolved in that aspect of my life. Sometimes I ask him what he thinks, but he is still so uninvolved in answering that question.
Has he ever expressed a negative opinion?
I think maybe once or twice.
Do you remember the outfits?
Yeah, I was wearing a Mongolian fur vest. And he was like, oh my God, let's take separate elevators. And I was like, oh my God, let's not go out together tonight. But other than that, no, he's super, super, super supportive. I the same way that I'm not trying to tell him what stocks to, he works in finance, I'm not trying to tell him what stocks to invest in. He's not trying to tell me what pants I should wear.
Well, moreover, I mean, like you just mentioned the harem pant thing on the subway. In general, you guys fell in love and grew together as you were doing exactly what you wanted, wearing whatever
what
you
wanted.
Yeah. Exactly. Okay. All right. What advice would you give to an 18-year-old girl with a desire to make it in the fashion industry?
This is tough. I would love to say just be yourself, because that's the first tool you need, but it's just the first tool.
It did work for you. I'm thinking to the
it
in
did,
the book when
I
you're talking
that,
about your internship with Valentino, right?
Yes.
And you kind of went in and were almost a little awkward and overeager
really
in a way,
awkward.
But you also got the job. You were yourself.
Right. I guess I was myself, and myself was an idiot.
But you still got the job. You still had the in.
I think. Checking those internship sites and making sure that you land at a place that you want to be in, that you're not just going because it's for the sake of an internship. And I worked for 5 years and my parents were like, when are you going to get paid already? And I was like, it's not how it works, you guys. It's not how it works. You don't get paid. This is not how business works these days.
Which actually makes me think about the exclusionary nature of fashion a little bit, which is when if you are not able to manage that, what is the best course of action? What do you do?
Well, isn't that the beautiful thing about a blog, is that it is sort of disenchanting the exclusionary nature of fashion? I feel like blogging has sort of given these uninitiated girls that are really excited and sometimes have a very educated and intellectual opinion, like a Susie Lau from Style Bubble or mm-hmm. Tavi Gevinson from Style Rookie, to sort of make a point and have that point be heard. George Saunders wrote The Brain Dead Megaphone, and it's one of my favorite collections of essays, and he talks about this megaphone that is so loud that everybody could hear it, and the essay was much more politically driven than the point I'm making, but you can argue the same things are happening with Twitter and Facebook and this sort of relentless having to hear what everybody is saying because the megaphone is on so loud. But the thing that's so beautiful is if you're able to carefully edit, you can choose what you want to listen to, and sometimes it's highly educational. And I really believe that blogging is sort of the beginning of this very democratic take on fashion.
Do you think the industry is kind of embracing that as is appropriate? Because I'm thinking just the time your blog really blew up was also the same time that the fashion industry was really starting to embrace, as much as the fashion industry can, embrace alternative media outlets. This is the moment at which bloggers were suddenly invited to fashion shows, which was a huge deal. That's a big step, but do you feel that the fashion industry is still kind of on the right side? Are they on the team with the blogs? Are they behind it? Are they worried?
Or what's so different or what's so difficult about fashion and traditional media pertaining directly to fashion is that it's all a control game. You know, these magazines and these companies want to own their space, and you can't own anything on the internet. You have to just pour out content and let it be taken the way that it's going to be taken. And so I think that that is still a problem that they're working through, and they're trying really hard to become a little bit more liberal about the way in which their sort of brand is their brands are being perceived, but I don't quite know that they're there yet.
Do you think they'll ever be there, honestly?
I think they have to. You know, if we're playing the survival of the fittest game, Darwin said yes, they have to be there.
Okay. All right, let's see. When you started the site, the clothes you chose to feature were very DIY and much more accessible. Now you deal with high fashion. Do you think you'll ever revisit the original idea of bringing more of the accessible pieces in?
I think
And how do you manage the mix, too?
I think I still do bring in a fair share of the accessible. I mean, right now I'm wearing jeans from Uniqlo and a t-shirt that I picked up at Topshop and a jean jacket that I bought on sale from the men's section of Acne for like under $100.
Right.
Let's forget about the shoes, though. I think that it's still a very, I would hope that it's still something of a happy medium between the two. And I would say that I shop mostly at Zara and Uniqlo because I'm a very trendy dresser, and therefore I'm constantly wanting trend pieces, and I cringe at the thought of spending excessive money on something I know I'm not going to want to look at 3 months from now.
Right.
But I also really still want to be true to myself. And if my style is evolving and that which I like is changing and I believe it's necessary for me to spend $300 on a shirt, I don't want to masquerade that, you know?
Well, it feels strange. If it's something you truly feel strong about and it's a piece, it's fashion is art to a certain extent. And, you know, it is how a person expresses themselves. So if you want to express yourself with jeans from Uniqlo and a shirt from Prada, I see, you know, I think sometimes
there's high-low mix.
Right. I feel like that's gotten extremely popular in recent years and kind of gives people an in into high fashion when they realize they don't have to wear head-to-toe, you know, Prada or what have you.
Like, yeah. I do also believe that the site is very much about my personal interaction with fashion.
Mm-hmm.
And, I mean, you can't fake stories that are really personal. And it's just a matter of what I'm buying and what is intriguing me and what is exciting me. And I hope that there's always a place for everybody to take something. And if it's not exactly what I'm wearing, it's inspired by what I'm wearing. But
right, or just the sense of confidence. Like,
absolutely. Yeah.
Okay. What is the most memorable item you've ever worn and why? So you do go through a lot of items in the book, but
I don't know if it's the most memorable. I'm going to say yes because it's always the first one that comes to mind, but my grandmother wore this enormous velvet jacket to my father's wedding, and she had it made specially for my dad's wedding, and it has all these crystals on the front, and the sleeves are huge, and I look like a pope when I wear it. And I was invited to the Valentino fashion show when I was abroad in Paris because I had worked there for so long, and my boss was going to be there, and she said, "We can give you a standing ticket." And I was like, that was a response.
Yeah.
And I wore it a couple of nights before. I wanted to take it for a test drive, and we were at a restaurant, and this French waiter came over to me and asked me why I was dressed like the Pope. And it wasn't so much that I was offended that he asked that. It's just that he said it in English. Why was his assumption that I was not French?
Which is really, when in France, that is the greatest insult, right?
Yeah,
when
they know you're not French. Or when you speak in French and they answer you in English.
Yeah, brutal. It hurts way more than
the Bermuda shorts happening all over again.
Yeah, no, more than any other country.
Yeah.
Maybe that's something about the French exuding such a level of chic. But
yeah.
When we talk about important items, actually, that reminds me of how you approached buying your wedding dress, where, you know, by your own account, the night you think you're getting proposed to, you give a lot of thought to your outfit. Actually, you know, various seminal moments in your life, you're giving a lot of thought to what you wear, but when it comes to the wedding dress, you're not exactly not giving it thought, but you're also like, we're getting this done ASAP.
Right. Well, my thing with the wedding dress is that if I were framing my life as, that seems so platitudinal, I'm framing my life now. If I were framing my life as this series of events that are informed by the clothing that I'm wearing, the wedding dress was this item that wanted to inform a very pivotal moment, but never could, just because it was the wedding dress. And so I didn't care about it because I knew that I was always going to have my memories from that night, whether or not I wore a bikini or a dress.
Right.
And I was also, I don't know, I ran into a friend today who just got engaged and she just quit her job because she's going to be so busy for the next few months planning her wedding. I get it. I really understand. I mean, wasn't judging her at all, but I just, no, right.
It's a lot of work. It is a lot of work.
It's a lot of work. And I just, to each their own, to me that felt like a signal that she wasn't she was maybe unknowingly unhappy at her job and this was her way out. So I certainly was not trying to judge, but I just, when I got engaged, I felt like it was like a chip off the block. I said, okay, this is something that I'm doing and I'm gonna get through. And I very famously told one of my husband's best friends when I was like 19 and desperately in love with him and he was not in love with me, that I just wanted to get marriage over with so I could focus on my career. And that is exactly what I did. I got marriage over with and I focused on my career.
So whereas for most women, this dress is ridiculously important. I mean, flip through any wedding magazine and it's kind of insane.
Yeah.
You know, for you, the dress, it wasn't, it's a wedding, it shouldn't be about the dress, but it often, the dress is so important. And for you, the dress was just kind of like, you had to wear something.
Yeah. My mom was very aggravated about the dress. It was, she made me get one. I would have worn a bikini.
Did she want to make it more of a deal or
no,
a to-do?
I think my mom was very, very instrumental in the planning of the wedding, and I think she just kept trying to remind me that it was my wedding and I could do what I wanted, and so the dress was something she left in my hands. So she did remind me several times that it was the only thing she left in my hands, and it took to the last minute to get.
But you did buy it on the first run.
Yes, it was
shopping,
the first
right?
dress I tried on. I had a
It was the first one you tried on?
Yeah. Wow. I saw it, I liked it, and I said, okay, let's get this one.
That's remarkably chill for a bride.
I really didn't care. I just wanted, first, I really wanted to marry Aby. I was just excited to be married to him. The wedding was beautiful, but I by no means consider it this very pivotal moment in my, I mean, the actual getting married was very pivotal, but where it was and the flowers that we had are just beautiful fodder for the rest of the story.
It's just a dress.
Yeah, it is. It's just a dress. This jean jacket, however.
On sale.
Yes.
So I think that's about it for us, but you are going to be signing books after this, and you should definitely come by. And we have drinks in the back. There's a bar. So please join us. And thank you, everybody, for coming tonight. It was really great to see everyone here.